Hello everyone, I am going to talk about client-centered therapy. Client-centered therapy was developed by Carl Rogers and his colleagues from the late 1930s onwards. It is also known as Rogerian psychotherapy, person-centered psychotherapy, person-centered counseling and non-directive therapy. Client-centered therapy is regarded as one among the other major psychotherapies such as psychodynamic psychotherapy or psychoanalytical therapy, Adlerian individual psychotherapy, cognitive behavioral therapy, existential psychotherapy, etc. Client-centered therapy is found to be effectively helpful for individuals to attain enhanced levels of personal happiness and adjustment. This therapy places much of the responsibility on the client for the effectiveness of the intervention, with the therapist taking a non-directive role. It aims to provide conditions for individuals an atmosphere of unconditional positive regard, a setting in which they realize that they will be accepted by another person no matter what they say or do. More congruence and less distortions together lead to greater trust that their individual selves can be relied on for effective relations with people and their environment. At the end of my talk, you will understand the evolution and aims of the client-centered therapy, client-centered therapeutic process, significance of therapeutic relationship and intervention strategies of client-centered therapy. This talk provides an introduction to Rogers' client-centered therapy, its characteristic features, goals and principles, besides the skills and techniques required to practice this therapy. Now, let me tell you about the historical background of client-centered therapy. Carl Rogers did a clinical psychology program at Columbia University and received his PhD in 1931. He had already begun his clinical work at the Rochester Society for the Prevention of Cruelty to Children. Rogers learned about Otto Rank's theory and therapy techniques, which laid the base for his own school of thought. He was offered a full professorship at Ohio State in 1940. In 1942, he wrote Counseling and Psychotherapy, which was his first book. Client-centered therapy was developed by Carl Rogers in USA from the late 1930s onwards, formerly known as non-directive psychotherapy. Rogers was a spokesman for humanistic psychology. Then, in 1945, he was invited to set up a counseling center at the University of Chicago. In 1951, he published his major work, Client-centered Therapy, wherein he outlines his theory. The theoretical core theme is the inevitability of non-judgmental listening and acceptance if clients are to change. He was known for originating and developing the humanistic movement in psychotherapy. Let me tell you about the humanistic existential perspective of Rogerian approach, which is based on the following assumptions. They are that people are essentially trustworthy. They have potential for understanding themselves and resolving their own problems without direct interventions from the part of therapists, and they are capable of self-directed growth if they are engaged in a therapeutic relationship. The attitudes and personal characteristics of the therapist and the quality of the client-therapist relationship are prime determinants of the outcome of the therapeutic process. The therapist's knowledge of theory and techniques are of secondary importance. Let me mention about the four stages in the development of Rogers' approach. The first stage, namely non-directive, was a reaction to the directive and traditional psychoanalytic approach. The therapist is invited to create a permissive and non-directive climate for the client. In this stage, he or she focuses mainly on reflecting and clarifying the client's verbal and non-verbal communications. He or she needs to accept whatever feelings the client expresses. The next stage is client-centered. Now, the focus shifts from non-directive method to the client's phenomenological world, that is the internal frame of reference of the client. Rogers contended that if the therapist offers a facilitative climate where congruence, acceptance and empathy were present and the client perceived these conditions, then therapeutic change would take place. The third stage coincides with the publication of his book, On Becoming a Person. Here, the focus is on the nature of becoming the self that one truly is. The fourth stage is person-centered. In this stage, one sees Roger's interest in knowing how people obtain, possess, share or surrender power and control over others and themselves. This approach aims at a greater degree of independence and integration of the client. Therefore, the focus is on the client rather than on his or her problem. This approach encourages openness to experience, trust in oneself, internal source of evaluation and willingness to continue growing. The two major goals of client-centered therapy are increased self-esteem and greater openness to experience. These goals are achieved by fostering the related changes in the clients through the therapeutic process. These are the related changes. 1. Closer agreement between the client's idealized and actual selves. 2. Better self-understanding. 3. Lower levels of guilt, defensiveness and insecurity. 4. More positive and comfortable relationships with others. And 5. An increased capacity to experience and express feelings at the moment they occur. Thus, the general aims of client-centered therapy are becoming more open to experience, achieving self-trust, developing an internal source of evaluation, and being ready to continually grow. Let me mention the key concepts of Roger's approach. 1. View of human nature. Actualization is a tendency towards the fulfillment of the potential, is the sole motivational construct in person-centered psychology. A function of the actualizing tendency differentiates a portion of one's experience into an awareness of self and the organization of a self-concept. The self-concept or self-structure is a consistent pattern of perception of the I or me in relation to the environment, personal values, goals and ideals. Rogers has a basic sense of trust in the client's ability to move forward in a constructive manner, if the appropriate conditions for growth are present. Clients are for him trustworthy, resourceful, capable of self-understanding and self-direction, able to make constructive changes and able to live effective and productive lives. The attitude of the therapist is of utmost importance for the change to take place in the client. Rogers identified three attitudes, namely congruence, that is genuineness or realness, unconditional positive regard, which means acceptance and caring, and accurate empathic understanding, or an ability to deeply grasp the subjective world of the other person. Because this approach believes in the capacity of the client to move forward in a constructive way, the primary responsibility for change rests with the client. 2. The basic characteristic of client-centered therapy. The responsibility and capacity of the client to discover ways to encounter reality more fully. Importance of the phenomenal world of the client. Growth taking place even outside the therapy through any type of caring and understanding relationship. 3. Nature of relationship. Let me highlight the nature of relationship between the therapist and the client. Significant positive personality change takes place only in a relationship. Therefore, according to Rogers, there are 6 necessary and sufficient conditions required for the change to take place in the client. These are 1. Two persons are in psychological contact. 2. The client experiences incongruence. 3. The therapist is congruent or integrated in the relationship. 4. The therapist has unconditional positive regard or real caring and acceptance for the client. 5. The therapist has an empathic understanding of the internal frame of reference of the client. And 6. The therapist communicates to the client empathic understanding and unconditional positive regard at least to a minimum degree. These 6 items are summed up in 3 attitudes of the therapist, namely congruence or genuineness, unconditional positive regard and acceptance, and accurate empathic understanding. 4. Congruence or genuineness. Let me briefly mention about congruence or genuineness. Congruence is the most important attitude on the part of the therapist. It simply means that the therapist is real, that is, he is genuine, integrated, and authentic during the therapy hour. There is no false professional front, and the therapist's inner experience and outer expression of that experience match. He is capable of expressing openly his feelings and attitudes that are present in the relationship with the client. By his authenticity, the therapist serves as a model for the client struggling towards greater realness. 5. Unconditional positive regard or acceptance. This implies deep and genuine caring for the client as a person. And this caring is unconditional, which is not contaminated by evaluation or judgment of the client's feelings, thoughts, and behavior. Acceptance is the recognition of the right of the client to have his own feelings, and it does not amount to the approval of all behavior. 6. Accurate empathic understanding. Empathy is crucial in client-centered therapy. The therapist understands the feelings of the client accurately as if they were his own feelings. It is a personal identification with the client's experience. The person-centered approach is helpful, especially in crisis intervention. A person in crisis wants to express himself fully. The therapist needs to listen sensitively and understandingly to the client in crisis. Now, let me tell you an illustration. A client has a problem which he wants to be solved. He meets a therapist who is trained in client-centered therapy. Let me role play the conversation between the client and the therapist. The client opens up saying, "Something bothers me for some time. I had a very good relationship with my father. I have two elder brothers who have not studied as I have done. From the very beginning, my father was very fond of me, and he used to compare my brothers with me and show me as a model, especially in studies. In the beginning, I liked it, but later, I realized that my father is partial to me, and my brothers feel that. Presently, I am staying away from my parents, and I come home once in a way. Last time, when I came home, I spoke to my father about this mistake of being partial to me. From that time onwards, he is not talking to me properly, and the intimate relationship we had has been broken. Now, I am disturbed about it." The therapist responds, "You realize that your father had been unfair with your other two brothers, and so you spoke to him about it, and in fact, that broke off the relationship with your father, and it worries you." Client replies, "Yes, now I find it difficult to face my father. Nowadays, when I go home, I avoid talking to him. At the same time, I know that my father wants to talk to me, but somehow I am not comfortable to talk to him." Therapist responds, "You feel uncomfortable to face your father and avoid any chance of talking to him. Will you speak more on your feeling of discomfort?" The client replies, "In a way, I would say that I am disappointed in my father. He is supposed to be fair to all the children. When it is a question of my brothers, my father is very hard on them." The therapist responds, "You are disappointed in your father as he is not good in dealing with your brothers." Client narrates, "It so happened last time when I was at home, I was alone and my father came home and we too happened to be together. It was a chance for my father to tell me all that he wanted to say. He was mostly complaining against my other two brothers. I did not say anything verbally, but kept on nodding my head." Therapist asks a question, "Were you satisfied with the type of response you made to your father?" Client replies, "Yes, that was all I could do. If I speak, he might misunderstand me, thinking that I am supporting my brothers." Therapist raises another question, "Do you think that your father was pleased with your response?" Client replies, "I am not quite sure about it." Therapist asks, if you were to tell me your concern in one sentence, what would it be? Client replies, I was very harsh with my father in dealing with our family problem and I am disturbed about it. Therapist asks, is it that you did not take into consideration the feeling of your father in addressing the family problem? Client replies, yes, that is my problem, I think. Therapist asks, can you give me a recent event of your being not sensitive to the feeling of your father? Client replies, 2 weeks back, when we were all together, my father, mother, two brothers and I raised the issue of our family problem. At that time, I was siding with my brothers purposely and my father felt sad about it. The therapist responds and questions, so, you realize that you had not been sufficiently sensitive to the feeling of your father. How should have you acted if you had been sensitive to the feeling of your father? Client replies, I should have been even-handed with everyone in dealing with the family problem. Therapist asks, you realize that you were not sufficiently sensitive to the feeling of your father. Now, what would be your goal? Client replies, in future, I shall be quite sensitive to the feeling of my father whenever we deal with our family problems. The therapist responds, you seem to be deciding to be fair in dealing with all the members of your family. Client replies, yes, I shall be so. Therapist asks, how could that be expressed more concretely? Client replies, when we discuss family matters, I shall give importance to my father and listen to him completely. On my part, I shall not blindly support my brothers, but will be fair in dealing with issues. Therapist checks, what you have decided seems good. Indeed, it is fine. What are you experiencing right now? Client says, I feel very much relaxed and clear about the issue and my involvement. Therapist asks, is there anything else you feel? Client says, I feel happy about my decision. Thank you very much for your availability and assistance. The therapist concludes, welcome, wish you all the best. From this illustration role played just now, we can understand that there are certain intrinsic features of client-centered therapy. The easy access and the presence of the therapist for the clients, intensive continual focus on client's phenomenological world, process marked by client's ability to live each moment fully, focus on personality change, not structure of personality. I would like to mention the target clients of client-centered therapy. The client-centered therapy has wide application within the helping professions, voluntary sector, human relations training, group work, education, and institutional settings where the goals are to foster good interpersonal skills and respect for others. This therapy is also useful in dealing with the clients in the first stage of crisis. Women clients would benefit from this therapy as they are encouraged to consider and identify their own feelings and needs, which many women may never have been able to do before. People with relationship difficulties would also benefit as the client-centered therapist gives them respect, understanding, and openness, which they may not have experienced in everyday life. The principles of the person-centered approach have been applied to a variety of therapeutic situations, including marriage counseling and family therapy. Many self-help groups like Alcoholic Anonymous extend core conditions of respect, understanding, and openness for people who want to change. Success is dependent on the therapist maintaining high trust in the feelings and actions of the client and themselves. Lack of trust often causes therapists to rely on passive reflection responses. These are necessary but become inadequate as the need for a more comprehensive therapeutic relationship develops, which includes directness that comes with culturally, situationally, and personally relevant feelings and interactions. Let me sum up. The client-centered therapy is optimistic in its view of humankind. Clients are seen as basically good and possessing the capabilities for self-understanding, insight, problem-solving, decision-making, change, and growth. The therapist's role is that of a facilitator and reflector. The therapist facilitates a client's self-understanding and clarifies back to the client the expressed feelings and attitudes of the client. In this therapy, giving information for problem solving is not usually considered the responsibility of the therapist. The therapist would not seek to direct the mediation of the therapist's inner world, but provides a climate in which the counselee could bring about change in himself or herself. The core conditions of therapy, as described by Rogers, are empathy, unconditional positive regard, and congruence or genuineness, considered necessary and sufficient for therapeutic personality change. The therapeutic skills are essential for the development of a therapeutic relationship between therapist and client, such as active listening, responding to clients through reflection of feelings and content, paraphrasing and summarizing, asking open questions, and responding appropriately to silence and client's nonverbal communication. Silence, acceptance, restatement, empathy, and immediacy responses occur most frequently with the client taking the lead on what is discussed and being responsible for outcomes. Client-centered therapists encourage careful self-exploration, but they tend to avoid confrontation and interpretation as tools for hastening insight. Let me sign off now and hope to meet you in another session. Thank you.